Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So today we are going to see what are logical operators in Java, right? So till the last lecture we have covered like how we can print something in the Java. So today we are going to see control statement in Java. So there are many control statements in Java, like one is if a statement. And the second one is if else. And third one is if else if later. Later you can say. So what are these and what is the importance of these control statement in Java? So let us see one real life situation. What can be the real life situation? So let me open Paint again.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there is a what is the default character? Like default values for all is zero in that way. What is the default character?
What you are saying?
What is the default character when you write a code?
Do you have any query? We can see it after the lecture. As well, let us discuss first if else statement, right?
Okay.
We will see that. So what is the real life situation? Like if I talk about, suppose you are getting the marks, your school has decided that if your total marks, or if you can say if your marks are greater than you can say 30, then you are passed. But if your marks are less than 30, then you are failed. So this is one real life situation. So while writing the program, if we want to represent the same situation in case of Java, how we can represent? We can represent using if else statement. So this is basically, it will help us to whatever the real life situation we are seeing here, we can represent with the help of if else statement. So how we can do, if I talk about in the programming way, so here this is my Eclipse editor. So let me first create one project, then only we can start. So I will go to create a project, Java, and then Java project. So this we have already seen, and I will give one name to my project. So the project name is, let me give class, or you can say project. So let me create. So this is one class that it got created automatically. Let me create this and create a new class that is not required. So let me create control main. So it cannot have a space. Thank you. Okay, so here this is my class. Let me just make font size bigger. Okay, so let me create main method. So main method is where our program execution will begin. So this is the shortcut control. If you want to, this is first you write like this control space. So it will show you this and hit enter. So here I will write my code. Suppose if I say int marks equals to, let me say student equals to, you can say 30. So if I say, if I want to represent the same situation which we have discussed in this paint editor, in this paint, which is this one, right? If marks are greater than 30, you have to say a student is passed. So if I say if student marks greater than 30, then what I will print, then I will print. So this we have already discussed that how you can print any statement in anything in Java with the help of this system.out.println. So I will say marks are greater than 30, then the student is passed. But if the marks are less than 30, automatically we can say a student is failed. So this we are saying. So we are just representing the real life situation. So let me also print it so we can see the output. Right. So now what will happen? So let us also see how we can debug a program. What debugging will how you can you will be able to see how debugging will help us. So what you have to do, put one double click here on this line, double click it. So this is our breakpoint. So if I right click and instead of choosing run as Java application, I will choose this one. So you can see what will happen. It will stop at this line number 8. So you can click on switch. So you can see it has stopped here, right? And you can see on the right hand side, one variable of type integer having the value 30 is created. So now if you see this, student marks greater than 30. So I should have taken, so it will be, so you can see here, what are the total marks? We are having student marks is 30. So is this condition true or false? 30 is greater than 30. It is condition is false. So now as the condition is false, we will come to this block. You can see here automatically at line number 14, it will not go inside, but it will directly come to this point because the condition is fail. So if I click this, you can say we are here. So I should have taken, let me take marks greater than equals to 30, which means I'm saying marks should be greater than 30, or if your marks are equals to 30, then the student is passed. Otherwise the student is failed. So if I say again debug as Java application, so now again we will stop at this point. So I have put breakpoint because I want to see how my program flow is working, right? So you can see again marks are 30. Now you can say condition is true, 30 is equals to 30. See, 30 is not greater than 30, but 30 is equals to 30. So one condition match, condition true, we will come inside of this, so which means student passed. So if I click this, now we are inside. So once if condition will become true, we will not going to go inside else block. So this is how if else statement will work. So now after that, our program execution, after this we will simply come to this point, right? So if I click this, now we are here, and after our program execution is also finished. So this is how it able. Are you able to get this? How we are using if else statement?
Yes, sir.
So let me take one more example. Like suppose. So let me first discuss two operator, right? So what I mean? We have already seen, I think, plus operator, minus operator, right? So let me comment this. What I mean? Suppose I want to find the remainder. when I divide the number. So if I say int a, so if I say int a equals to 7 by 4, or you can say 7 by 2, and if I try to print it, I want to find the remainder. Remainder equals to a. So if you think that this will give you remainder, what will be the remainder? 2 7 divided by 2, remainder will be 1. But if I execute this program, you will see the 1 will not be the output. It should give you 3. Let us see how it is giving us 3. You can see we are not getting the remainder. So basically, when you are dividing, let me go here. When we are dividing 7 by 2, so suppose if you are dividing in Java, if you are dividing, you can say this is 7, this is 2. So if you say 2, 3, 6, 1. Right, and after that you will put one decimal point here and put 0 here. So this is how we will divide normally. So this is the, so in the output, if you want to get the remainder, if you say 7 by 2 in Java, if you say 7 by 2, this is the actual value you are getting. So why it is giving you 3, not 3.5? Because what is happening here, both of these are integer, right? So this is an integer and this is also an integer. As it is not a floating value, what is a floating value? So what is a floating value? Let me write it here. So like 2.5 2.35, right, 1.9. so these are all the decimal point value. So if you want to get the correct output, it will not give you, because both of these are integer value and it is only taking the first integer. It is not going to give you after decimal digit. So if you want to see output, you will write this. So if I say 7.0 like this, and if I say 2.0, so it should be, let me write f, okay, not like this, but I will do 7 by 2, and here I will say instead of integer I will make it float. So let us see whether it is giving us the required value or not. So if I run it again, so now again it is giving 3.0, because both of these values are, why it is giving us 3.0, not 3.5? Because again both of these are integer. So what I can do, if I say 2.0, if I say, yeah, like this, if I say 7 by 2f, what will happen? Let us see. So now it is giving us, so basically in Java, if you want to represent any integer by floating value, which means now it is considered as a floating value after writing f after that. So now this is an integer and this is a floating value, which means in the decimal. So now this is how you can get the accurate result. Are you able to get what I am trying to say?
Yes, sir. If I use 7 to 6,
7?
If I replace 7 to 6,
like here?
Yes, sir.
So it should be 3.0. Let us check, it should give you 3.0. Right?
Okay, sir.
So, but our, actually, I needed to show this, but we need to find the remainder. Still, we did not get the remainder. What is the remainder here in case of this? It should be 0, right?
Sir, can you show this error?
It will give you 3. Wait a minute. Right? As it is an integer, it will going to put any decimal.
No.
So now you can see we are not getting the remainder. This is not the remainder, this is the
simple.
Put yourself on mute, some noise is coming. So what we can use, if we want to find the remainder, this is not giving us the remainder, this operator. But if we use this percentile operator like this, this will give you the remainder. How it will give you? So suppose if I say 8, this, and then I will say 7, right? So this time if you put this operator 7, so this is the remainder. So if you use this percentile operator, now this will going to give you the remainder. So similarly, if I show you here, instead of this one, if I say this operator percentile one, so now this will going to give you the remainder as 0. You can see. Similarly, if I change it to, you can say 86, or let me take 9 modulo by 2, right? So I will say, what is the remainder? It will be 1. So are you able to get that, how we can get the remainder? This operator will going to give us the remainder. Similarly, if I say 79, again it will be 1. So you can see again the remainder is 1. Like if I give you, instead of this one, if I give 8, and here if I give 3, so the remainder will be 2. Let us check. So remainder will be 2, right? So remainder is 2 here. So this is how we can get the remainder. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Okay. So let us make one program using if else condition to get, right? Suppose I want to check whether a number is even or odd, right? So I want to check whether a number is even or odd. So what I can say, suppose this is my number. Number is 77. I want to check this number is odd, right? So what I will do, if suppose, again let me write if else condition, and in the else condition I will write, or let me start from here, I will say if number modulo by 7, again we need to find the remainder to check whether the it should be 2 here, because we need to check for the even. So if the number is completely divisible by 2, it will be even. So when I will find the remainder of number by dividing it by 2, if the remainder is equals to, we are comparing whether the remainder is equals to 0, right? If the remainder is double equals to 0, I will say, so basically this double equal to is comparing both the value. If these both the value of these, this one and this one are equal, condition will become true and we will come inside. So I will print number is even, and in the else part I will say number is odd. So let us again just put one breakpoint here, line number 14, and debug the program so we can get a clear understanding. So again we are here. Now our program execution has stopped here. So you can see 77 modulo by 2, right? So if I write it here, what will be the output? If I write 77 modulo by 2, so this will give us the remainder. So what will be the remainder? Is it equals to 0? It will be equals to 1, right? So once this evaluates to 1, 1 is equals to 0, condition false. So we will come out of this if condition, and we will navigate to this, right? Whenever if condition will become false, we will directly jump to this 22 line. So if you get condition false, now we are here. So it is saying that number is odd, right? Similarly, if I change it to this, suppose this time if I take one even number, so if I take 78, so this time if I modulo this number by 2, this will give you the remainder as 0. So these two conditions will become true, and we will simply print this statement. So if I debug this program again, So again, what is the numbers? So these are the commented part. I'm just commenting this line. So this is not a part of our program, right? So I'm just commenting that. So after that, number is 78. So if I 78 multiply by 2, the remainder will be 0. So condition will also become true, right? Because if you module 78 by 2, you will going to get the output as 0. So if you get the output as 0, now we will, both the condition are true. Condition true, so we will come inside. So now you can say we are coming inside, and this time we are not going to touch else part because this condition has become true. Now we will print the statement, and after that you will see we will not going to else part. We will simply reach here, this part, line number 32. So this is again a commented part. So now we are going to reach here. So now you can see the number is even. So this is basically, we have made one simple program of Java to find the number is even or odd. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us discuss one more. Suppose I have one more condition. Suppose you are in a school or you are in a college. So your college has decided one thing, like if the marks of a student is between, like you can say marks is greater than 20, marks are greater than 20, or you can say marks are greater than, you can say if marks greater than 70 but less than, if your marks are greater than 70 but marks are less than 90, so you will get first division, right? Just assume. So you will get first division. But if your marks are greater than, you can say greater than 50, and your marks are less than, you can say less than 60. So in that condition, you will get second division, right? So this is some dummy example I'm taking. And suppose if both the condition will not match, or let me take one more, if your marks are, you can say greater than 30 and less than 40, you will get third division. So this is what your college has decided. But if both the three conditions will not match, you will say that your college is saying that you will fail. If you are getting the marks less than 30, you will fail. So now I want to represent the same situation in case of using else if, right? So here we can not use if else alone. So what we can do, let me tell you here. So let me create one more class. So I will copy this and I will paste. So save the file first and copy. So this is Ctrl+2. So I just copied 2 times. So let me delete one file. Okay, so some issue is there. Let me create new class. Control. Okay, so I will check it after why it is creating two classes. Anyways, we have to see the code. So I will copy this code again. So let me not copy the code, let me write here. So again, I have to create the main method, and I need to represent the same situation which my college has decided in the form of code. So suppose int, let me take student marks equals to, you can say 44, just assume this is the condition. So variable name cannot have a space, so let me give like this. So now these are the marks for student which he has got. So I will put some condition. If you can say marks are greater than 70, right? And if you see, and if I write double logical AND operator, what is this operator? I will tell you. And if the marks are less than 90, which means, sorry, this should be, I'm using incorrect variable name. So if marks are greater than 70 and marks are less than 90, which means a student can have the marks between 70 and 90. If this is the case, so I will print the student got first division. So this is the condition I have written. So instead of using else part, there is one more which we have already discussed. Like if I write it here, there are three. So first is if else statement, other is else if. So what is else if will do? So if you want to use instead of else, what I will, if this is the condition, then this is the we are going to print. But if that condition is not matched, we have to put one more condition. If student marks, you can say greater than, you can say 50. If student marks are greater than 50 and the student marks less than, you can say less than 70, right? So what will be the case? The student will get second division. So this we have discussed in the paint as well, that our college has decided this. So student got second division. Now there is one more condition. If I go here, I need to put one more. So you can put any number of conditions you want. Here we have only three conditions. If student marks, you can say greater than 30 and student marks, you can say marks, you can say less than 50. So here on the top we have taken greater than 50. So I'm just saying marks are between 70 to 90. If this is what this statement means, 70 marks are between 70 to 90. And here I'm saying marks are between 50 to 70. And here I'm saying if the marks of the student are between 30 and 50, so what will happen? The student will get third division. But if all the conditions are not matched, which means that a student is getting the marks less than 30 as well. So I will, after that you can use else condition if you want. So I can say else, if none of the condition matched, which means the student failed. So let us see in the debug mode again. So let me do one thing. Let me put greater than equals to sign, because if I say greater than 70, so it will not take the 70 value. So if I say greater than equals to, so it will also take the 70 value and the 90 value. So I can say 70 to 90, less than 70 and greater than 50, and here greater than 30 and less than 50, right? So if you see this, so let us see the truth table of this AND operator, like how it will work first. So this, many of the people have already know about logical AND operator. So there is one in our college days, there is one subject, I think it is digital electronics, I remember. So there we have many operators like this. So let us discuss this. So if I see, suppose this is column number A and this is column number B, right? So if I say AND operator, if this condition will become true and this condition will become true, then you will get the output as true, right? If this is false, then definitely you will going to get the result as false. and if it is true, if it is false, and if it is true, then this will become false. And if it is true and if it is false, then you will going to get the false. So what is this logical AND operator? Logical AND operator, right? So it will going to give you output as true when both the conditions will become true. Otherwise it will give you false. If any of this condition will become fail, you can see here output is going to be false. So similarly here what we are trying to say, student marks are 40. So let me put breakpoint. Double click this line here, right click, debug as Java application. So you can see here I am just checking. You can see if this 44 number is between 70 to 90, condition false. You can clearly see here, because this condition will become false, 44 is not greater than equals to 70, condition false. And let me do here, let me try to write it here. What is our first condition? You can see our marks are our 44, right? So in the first condition I am saying if 44 is greater than equals to 70, this is what I am saying in the statement, and I am saying 44 less than equals to 90. So this condition is false because 44 is not greater than equals to 70, so this condition is false, and but this condition will become true because 44 is 90 is greater than 44, so condition become true. But if you see this false and true, this will going to give you as result as false. So this first statement, total of this statement, condition will become false. So inside this, if a statement false will come, and as it is false, we will not going to get inside this, right? So you can see this, we will not going to get inside this line. So you will see now this is our next statement. Now again, is 44 greater than 50, condition false. So you do not have to check the remaining condition in case of logical AND. If one condition fail, we are very sure that we will not go inside this. So again, condition fail. Now you can see, now we are coming to third condition. So what is our third condition? 44 should be greater than equals to 30, and 44 should be less than equals to 50. So let us check whether it is correct or not. So what is our third condition? In the third condition, I am saying 44 greater than equals to 30, and logical AND operator, and 44 less than equals to 50. So this condition, if you see, so 44 and 30 both are not equal, but 44 is definitely greater than 30. So this is how it will work. So condition become true. And you can see 44 is not equals to 50, but 44 is definitely less than 50. So if this is the case, condition become true. So as it is a logical AND operator, if you are getting both the statements and true, output will be true. This will be true. So if it is true, if this condition will become true, we will going to get inside this. You can see here, if I click this, now we are here, right? And because one of the condition matches, this statement will not be executed. So this is how it will work. And if I click this, you can see it is executed, but you will see this will not be executed at all because condition matches here only. So now if I, you can see after this, program has finished. So this is how you can put multiple conditions in else if statement. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
So suppose if I say, suppose this time one student got 22 marks. So if the student got 22 marks, both of all these conditions will become fail because this is the minimum condition if a student has to get the third division. But I'm saying marks are equals to 22. So in this case, what will happen? So if I run it, So this will fail, this will fail, this will fail. So if both the all the conditions will become fail, this will execute at the last, right? If all the conditions will fail, but if any of the condition matches, this will not execute, right? So earlier we also seen that, but now all the conditions false. So we will definitely come to else part, and I am simply saying student fail because the student is getting the marks less than 30. So this is what the else part will do here. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Sir.
Yeah.
How to take the input from the user and then check the conditions?
Yeah, let me also show you. So we have not discussed class and object. So basically there is a one class which is called scanner class in Java, right? So that will help us to take the inputs from the user, because this is the what I am entering every time, right? I want that. Please, can you put yourself on mute? Some noise is coming because in the recording it will be also there. So there is one scanner class in Java. So what is class and object? We will discuss when we will start object-oriented programming. As of now, just see how we can take the input from user. So first you have to create the object of this scanner class. So what is object of this class? We will discuss when we will start object-oriented programming. So, and here you have to pass one argument. So this is called argument, which is system.in. So what is system.in? Again, I'm saying, just do not think about it because we have not discussed object-oriented programming. Then you can, so here you are multiple import statement. So click this java.util. This. Mayuri, can you put yourself on mute?
Hello.
Okay. So now what I am saying, in Java, if you want to take the input from user, we can use this class, right? So what is object in class? We will discuss from object-oriented programming. So as of now, just see here. If you want to get the input from user, first I will say system.out.println. Enter the marks. Sorry, marks of the student, right? So this is the statement I will give, and here I will say int marks equals to, so there is one which method which is next int. So this method will help us to enter the data. So how this will work, so let me remove this. So or let me put, so how this these three lines will work, let me again debug the program. So again, let me put breakpoint here to line number 9. So let me take, okay, let me put here only. So if I debug this program, so this time I am not hard coding any data. I am taking the data from user. So this line will be printed first, right? So line is printed. Now it is saying enter the marks of a student, right, on this line. So basically what will happen? When I execute this line, so if I execute this line, let me first execute. So now here I need to enter the marks. Once this line is executed, I need to enter the marks. So let me say 88, right? So what will happen? What this method will do? Once I hit enter, after that, once I hit enter, this value, whatever you are displaying here, whatever the value is displaying, I have entered here, this 88 value will be put into the left hand side variable. So as of now you can see it do not have any value, right? But once I hit enter, after that, whatever the value I have written here, this method, next int method, will take this value from here and put it here. So you can see marks are 88, and after that again the flow will be same. We got the marks, so I think this time this condition will become true. So we will go get inside and it will print the first division, right? And rest of the statement will not execute because condition matches. So this is how you can also take the input from user using a scanner class. So this is clear to everyone?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So just do not worry about object and class. We will discuss from object-oriented programming. Again, I am saying. So if you want to take the input from user, you can say this one, right? So let us discuss one more operator here. Suppose instead of this one, there is one more operator which is called logical OR. So let me remove, or let me write it here only. So there is one more operator which is logical OR. So this is the sign symbol of logical OR. So how this, what is the truth table of this? If I say A logical OR B, so true, if both the condition are true, you will get the output as true. If false or true, you will get true. If true or false, you will also get true. But if both the conditions will become false, in that case only you will going to get the statement output as false. If one of the condition is true, which means in case of logical OR operator, if one of the condition will become true, you will get the output as true. Otherwise, if both the conditions will become false, then only you will get the output as false. So let us see here as well. If I change it to this one, what will happen? If I say let me remove this. So let us keep things simple. So what will happen here? Once I will enter the marks, suppose if I, let me first enter the marks. So again debug the program. So enter the marks. So what are the marks? So if I say marks are greater than, let me say, if I say marks are 60, if the marks are 60 and if I hit enter, sorry, before that first need to execute this line. So execute this line. Now we are here, right? So if you see this, if marks are greater than 60, so you can see this condition is become false because the 60 is not greater than 70. Condition false. This condition. So this condition has become false because 60 is not greater than 70. So this is false. But if you see this part, 90 value 60 is less than 90. So this become true. So one of them is false. This is true and this is false. But as we are using OR operator, if one of the condition matches, this whole output will become true. So this basically become true. So that's why we will going to get inside this statement. So this is how this will be. So now we are here, right? Because one of the condition matches, that's why we are going inside this. So now this will be printed and after that our program will terminate. So this is how logical OR operator will work. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So now what we will see, what is switch statement in Java. And why do we need that, right? So let us see. Let me just undo all the operation which we have done. So this is where we were. So let me also comment this. You can try that after to take the input from user. So some error is coming, variable is not there. And if I write 22, right, and let me create one more class. Switch. So why we are using switch statement? First let us understand how we can write it. Suppose if I say again int, sorry, first we have to create one main method, because from the main method our program execution will start always. So So if I say int marks equals to, you can say, or let me take some equals to 90. Simple, take this, marks are 90. And now what we do in the switch statement, how you can write, first you have to use the switch keyword. So switch, and here write the variable name. And here what I will do, marks, and inside this switch statement, what you have to do, you have to make the cases. So you can create any number of cases. So for example, if I say, or let me take some 77, right? Or let me take 70. So we will put different cases in here. I will say if any student get the marks equals to, suppose 40, or you can say 50. There is one case I am saying, if the student is getting the marks equals to 50, if the student is getting the marks equals to 50, then I will print student got third division. Right, so this is one thing. And suppose I will make one more case, you can say 60. If that is the case, if the student is getting the marks equals to 60, I will say student got second division. And there is one more case, if I say marks equals to 70, case. So if the student is getting the marks equals to 70, the student will get, or let us take 90. If the student is getting the marks equals to 90, the student is getting first division. So this is some dummy example I have created. So how this will execute? So if I again put breakpoint here, so what will happen, as this value is 90, directly this will not going to see all both the cases, because the value is different here. It will simply go to this third statement. So if you want to see, let me put breakpoint here, and if I execute this, you can see we came to case number 90, because this 90 is matching with this value. So now we have used this switch case statement, and we are printing that student got first division. So, but we can do the same case with the help of if else statement as well, which we have seen earlier. So why we are using this switch case statement? So anyone wants to tell that why we are using switch statement if we have if else statement? We can do the same thing with the else if statement. So why we are using switch case here? Why we should use? Anyone wants to add some points?
Because in if condition, the loop will get executed again and again. But if the first condition is satisfied at the first place, then we don't have to traverse the loop.
So let me explain here only. Suppose if I do the same thing here, what is happening? Let me run it again first. So let me just write it here. If I perform the same thing with else if statement, suppose if, so let me take marks variable again. Into marks 90, right? So if I say if, so let me take some other marks, you can say 33. So if the student is getting 33, he will be fail. If I say if marks equals to 90, you can say first, so it is first division. If So let me take else if if marks equals to equals to, you can say 70. We can take 70, right? Second division. And if I say else if marks equals to 33. So this time student will be failed. So if I run this program, how it will execute? You can see here, it will execute like this. So first statement will execute first, right? So let me, here we have to check the condition at every line. So this will be slower if we have more condition. So let me try to run. So you can see, in the switch case statement, if you remember, when I am executing this line, these two are not executing because here the condition is not checking. We are directly reaching to line number 3, which is case 90. But here if you see, here it will compare all the conditions one by one, and when it will find this last condition, it will go inside, right? So it will execute one by one. So first this will check, after this will be checked, and at the last this will check. So the, here it is true, so this will fail. So if you have, here we have only 3 conditions, but if you have somewhere around 100 condition, so first, and if your this will be written at 99th line, so first 98th line will be executed, and then you will see this output. So it will become slow. But here if you see this, let me take marks equals to 33. So suppose if the student marks are 33, so I can put one more case. Sorry, case 33. So student fail. Right. Now here, as the marks are 33, these three conditions will not be executed. You can see if I put the breakpoint here, here, and here, right? So it should stop the execution, but it will directly come to this point, right? So if I, now marks are 33, and if I execute this, it will directly reach to this. So it has skipped these three conditions and directly came here. So it, here it will be faster as compared to that else if statement. Are you able to get the difference why we can use switch case as well?
Yes, sir.
Suppose if I write, here if I write 50, what will happen? Let us try to execute. If I write 50, this condition will become true. We will come here directly. Now this will be printed. But after that, it is also taking all the cases after the line, after that 50. So whatever the cases it is seeing after this 50, similarly, if you write 60 here, so after 60 it will print. So how, what we can do, we can put one break statement here. So always, if you're using switch case statement, always put break, otherwise it will run all the cases. So once this case will finish, I will say break. And here I will say also break, which means once it will find this, after printing the this line, it will find break and it will simply come out of this switch case, right? So always put a break. Let me also put break. So if I run this again, so here also you can take the input from user. So now again marks equals to 50. So this condition true, but after that you are using break statement. So what this break statement will do, it will simply move you out of the switch case statement. So now directly you will reach line number 26. So if I put, so let me execute this. You can see directly we are, after using break statement, we are simply coming out of this switch case. Is it clear to everyone why we are putting break statement? This time it has only executed only one case, which we want. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Yeah. So there is one more case, which is called as default case. So if I write, what is this default case? So let me write system.out.println. You can say condition marks condition does not match. So sometimes it is just like else statement. If none of the condition match, this will execute. So what will happen? Suppose if I write 150. So you can see 150 is not matching with any of the numbers, right? Any of the cases. In that case, this will be executed, right? So if I try to run, else the condition is not matching this time. So marks are 150. Now you can see directly we will came to this block because 150 is not matching with these four value. So this is how you can also put default case here. So this is called as the default case. If not, you can also put break after that, but here after that we do not have any statement, so only this will be executed. So you can say marks condition does not match. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Great. So let us discuss now one more important concept, which is what are loops in Java. So we have seen what are control statements, a switch, if else, else if statement, right? So we have seen, we have covered this. Let me open Paint again. Suppose I want to print name of a person 5 times. Let me create one more class, new class. I want to, let me put, I want to print name of a person 5 times. So how you can say? One time. And then I will copy the same statement. Second time, third time, fourth time, fifth time. Suppose 10 times I need to print. So this is how I will write. And if I run this program, it will print Ankit whatever the times I have written. So total, I think 10, right? So whatever be the count. So similarly, suppose if you want to print the, if you want to print this name 100 time or 200 time. So will you going to repeat this lines 100 times? So this is not a good thing. We are repeating the same thing again and again. So here, basically here comes the concept of loops in Java. So basically, if we want to perform the same operation, we are performing the same operation again and again. Right. So what is the definition? If we want to perform the same operation again, then we will use loops. So there are loops in Java, right? One of the loop name is for loop. Second is while. Third is do while. Right, so let us discuss what is, so are you able to get why we are using loop? Because I do not want to call this 100 times. So now let me open Paint again. So first let us discuss for loop. For loop. So what is the syntax? For. So here you have to, let me put semicolon. Suppose I need to, if I write, so let me take one variable. I, you can take any variable, I equals to 1. So basically here you have to declare your variable, right? And here you have to tell when to stop the loop, right? So there must be some criteria when you have to stop your loop. So let me take when I less than 4, when I will be less than 4, stop the loop. And here I will say, what is this? it is increment operand plus plus I, which means I am incrementing the value of I by 1. So let us see how this will execute. So let me go here. This is basically variable. Here we are declaring the variable. So variable initializing the value. Right here I am saying what is this bit between part, a stopping condition. So if we do not put any stopping condition, how it will know that when to stop? So this is our stopping condition. And here I am just saying plus plus I means incrementing the value of I by 1 each time. By 1 we are incrementing. So now how this will execute? So always remember, whatever you are seeing here, this part, this will, in all the for loop, whatever the for loop you will write, this will only execute once. So here I am writing I equals to 1, only execute one time. It will only execute one time. After that it will not execute. So once this will execute, this will execute. So suppose in your memory area, I equals to 1 will be created. So this is your memory area, assume I equals to 1 will be created. So this is the value. Now after that, this condition will be checked. Is 1 is less than 4? Because the value of I is 1. So 1 is less than 4, condition true. So if the condition is true, so what will happen? We will go inside. So whatever the statement you will write here, system.out.print, I am writing in short, hello, right? So once we will go inside, this will simply execute the statement. So in your output, you will see hello one time, right? And after this, there are no more statements. So after this, it will execute the last statement. So this is how it will work. Now this will be executed at the last. So plus plus I, which means increment the value of I by 1. So this will become 2, right? Now again, we will start from this second point. This will only execute one time. Again, I am repeating. Now again, this condition will be checked. Is 2 is less than 4? Is 2 is less than 4? Condition true. We will go inside. Again, this will be printed. So hello will be second time, right? And after that, again, this last statement will be executed. Increment the value of I by 1. So I will say it will become 3, right? So now, once it will become 3, again this condition will be checked. Is 3 is less than 4? Condition true. Again we will go inside. So once we will go inside, again it will print hello, right? And after that, again last statement will be executed. So it will make the value of I equals to 4. So I value will become 4 now. Now again this middle condition will be checked. If you see this time, 4 is less than 4, condition is false. So if the condition is false, we will not go inside. So once the condition will become false, we will come out of our for loop. We will come out of our for loop and it will not execute it anymore. So this is how we the working of the for loop will happen. Is it clear to everyone?
So I have a question. So it will print 3 times, right? Hello?
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you write equals to here, less than equals to, then this condition will also be true. And now it will print 4 times. It will print 4 times in this case. So let us see in the Eclipse editor as well how it will work. So instead of printing Ankit these many times, I will write this statement once, and now I will use for loop. Int I equals to 1, I less than equals to 4. You can give 50, 40, any number. Let us give 4. Increment the value of I by 1. And here I will put this statement. So let us see how this will execute. So put breakpoint. Debug as Java application. So always, if you are doing the programming for Java programming for the first time, always try to debug the program. It will help you. So you can see int I equals to 1. First, this will be created inside our memory area. So this is created, right? So this will execute only once. Now these two will execute till the last. So now, is 1 is less than 4? As 1 was less than 4, we came inside. First we came inside, and after this will execute, this will execute at the last. So if I execute this, you can see after that, once this is finished, this will be executed. So you can see on the right hand side, after I execute this, this value will become 2, and 2 is less than 4, and 2 is less than 4, we will again come inside. So if I execute this, you can see on the right hand side, it will become 2. So 2 is less than 4, again we will come inside. And after that, this will execute it, Ankit, second time. Now again, this condition will execute at the last. So it will become 3 this time, and 3 is less than again 4, condition true. You can see on the right hand side, value become 3. And after that, after that, this will be executed. Now again, what will be the value? It will become 4, and 4 is less than equals to, see, you can see after that, once it will become 4, 4 is not less than 4, but 4 and 4 are equal. So one condition matches, condition true, we will again go inside. So on the right hand side, value will become 4. So now the condition become true, we will come inside, and it will print Ankit. But after that, value of I will become 5, right? Value of I will become 5 once I execute this line, line number 7. So then once value will become 5, so 5 less than equals to 4, condition fail. So now we will not execute this for loop. So we will simply come out of this for loop. So this is how it will work. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I will tell you in a short while, okay? Just let us come to first while loop, then we will tell. So here you can, if you write it here, I plus plus as well, that will not affect it. So basically what will happen, we will see that in case of while loop, right? Just after this for loop. So first tell me whether if you write like this, then also it will not affect. But if you use the same thing in the while loop, then it will affect. We will see that in the while loop, just after for loop. So first tell me whether for loop is clear to everyone.
Yes.
So let us see one more variation of for loop, which is called as let for loop. So there will be multiple for loops inside one for loop. So suppose this is my for loop, I plus 2, 1, I less than, or we can say less than equals to 2, increment the value of I. And inside this for loop, there is one more for loop. There is one more for loop. So I can say j equals to 1. This is another for loop. J less than equals to, you can say 1. Let me take 1 and increment the value of j. And here I am giving some statement, system.out.println. It is called as hello. And here, okay, so after that, how this will execute, we have to see. So this will execute only one time. So in your memory area, I equals to 1 will be created, right? So I equals to 1 will be created. If I equals to 1 is created, now this condition is checked. Is 1 is less than equals to 2? Is it correct? Yes, 1 is less than 2. So we will come inside, right? So now this last statement will not execute as of now, because we are coming inside. Now when it will come inside, it will again execute the inner for loop. So this will execute it only one time. So j equals to 1 will be created in your memory area. Only one time it will execute. Now condition is true. 1 is equals to 1, condition true. 1 is not less than 1, but 1 is equals to 1, so condition true. So now we will go inside and simply print hello in our output. This will print hello. And once this will be completed, this will execute at the last, right? So increment the value of j. So j value will become 2. But after that, once this condition will be checked again, this condition become false because 2 is not less than equals to 1. So now we will simply come out of our inner for loop. So now we came out of our inner for loop. And if you remember, once we came inside, we have completed all the inner statement. Now this will be executed at the last. So now I value will become 2. I value will become 2. Now again, this condition will be checked. This condition will be checked. If 2 is less than equals to 2, condition true. So we will go again inside, right? So when you'll come inside, again this will execute fresh, right? And the for loop will again execute. So let me, you know, now when you will come inside for the second time, again this will execute one time freshly. So now j equals to 1 will be created again. Now condition true, 1 is less than 1. We will again go inside, print the hello statement in our output. And once this will be printed, again this condition will be executed at the last. So j value will become 2. J value will become 2. So but this condition is now incorrect because 2 is not less than equals to 1. So now we will simply come out of our inner for loop. We will come out of this for loop. And now at the end, this will execute this one plus plus I. So again, I value will become 3. And after that, once this condition will be checked, so 3 is less than equals to 2. Condition false. So now our outer for loop will also terminate. So total of 2 times you will see hello in your output screen. So this is how nested for loop will work. Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone?
Sir, while we go I 3 value, if condition I is equal to I greater than or equal to 2. So if here I condition is 2, so while we go I is value 3.
See, after this, once earlier our value was 2 here, which we have written, I have cut it. So once value 2 will become condition true, we will go inside, we will complete this. But once after I come out of this inner for loop, this will execute it at the last. So now this has made our value 3 at the last. And once our value is become 3, this condition will become false. So this is how it will work. So should I explain one more time if you want?
Yes.
Okay, let me just take here how it will execute. It is again same as the I equals to 1. Let me take I less than equals to 1 plus plus I, or I plus plus, you can write anything. So let me print hello. Suppose I am printing hello. How this will work? So first you have to understand this. So once I value equals to 1, this will execute only one time. So this is executed. Now condition true, we will go inside. It will print hello. Right? It will print hello. But after printing hello, this will execute at the last. So it will make the I value as 2. And now this condition will be checked again. This time condition became false. So we will simply come out of our for loop. Right? So this part is clear to everyone how it is working, how it is making the I value equals to 2.
So in that yes, case, sir. What it will print, like if it makes when it checks here again, when it becomes 2.
Yeah.
So what it will print then?
No, it will not print now because I am saying. When your I value is 1, condition true, we will go inside. So output will become, it will be hello. But after printing hello, this will execute. So I value will become 2. I value will become 2. But this condition become false because 2 is not less than equals to 1. This condition is false. So if this middle condition will become false, we will never going to get inside. We will never go inside this for loop. And it will terminate. So it will only print hello one time. So this is how it will work.
So there will be no output.
No output.
Okay.
We have already seen if I run it here. Yeah. If I run it one time, right? Suppose. It will only print Ankit one time. only Ankit is printed, right? So whatever the output you will see only when you write this statement, otherwise there will be no output, right? So similarly, in case of a nested for loop here, which we have discussed, the same thing is happening. Let me take for I equals to 1, I less than equals to, let me take 2, plus plus I, and here for j equals to 1, so I am taking the same example again, j less than equals to 1, plus plus j, increment the value of I. So it should be, let me print hello. Okay, so now how it will execute, let us see again. I equals to 1 will be created, this is created, in that it will execute only one time, this one. Now condition true, this middle condition is true, 1 is less than equals to 2, so we will go inside. Once we will go in, so you can see here, this is not executed, last statement is not executed, it will be executed once all this statement will be finished inside the outer for loop. So now we will go inside. So now again j value will become 1, it will execute it one time, condition, middle condition is true, this will be true, we will go inside, print hello, and after this hello will be printed, this statement of inner for loop will execute first. So j value will become 2. So once j value will become 2, this condition will be checked again, if 2 is less than 1, condition false, so we will not go inside the inner for loop anymore, and this will not going to print hello again, and we will come out of this inner for loop, right? So hello will be printed. So after that, this, once all the statements inside this in outer for loop will finish, this statement will execute at the last. So what is the value of I will become? It will become 2. So once it will become 2, again the same statement will repeat. So again, similarly, it will again print hello second time, and once this statement will be finished, again this will execute. So you can see here, this will execute again at the last. So now this will become 3, first it was 2, now it will become 3. Now again this condition will be checked, is 3 is less than 2, is 3 is less than equals to 2, condition false. So now this condition also become false, and we will simply come out of our outer for loop. So now it is clear why it is, why the value I am writing 3 here.
Yes.
So let us do the same thing in here. If I write, yeah, here if I write same thing, so let me take I less than equals to 2. And here inside this one more for loop. So there can be many for loops. There can be 3 for loops. But let us see first. So it should be 1. So if I write, so put breakpoint, so I should have put breakpoint here anyways. So you can see I equals to 1 is created in the output, in the memory, I equals to 1 is created on the right hand side. Now 1 is less than 2, as 1 is less than 2, we will go inside. So it will, this for loop will keep on executing till this condition will not become false. This, so this is how it will work. So now again j value will be created. So if I click this, now on the right hand side j equals to 1 is created, and 1 is less than equals to 1, so this condition will become true, we will come inside, it will print the hello. Now hello is printed. Now after that, as of now j value is 1, but this will execute at the last, right? So now j value will become 2. So if j value will become 2, this condition will become false. If this condition will become false, we will come out of our inner for loop. So if you see j equals to 2, it will be j equals to 2, right? So condition was false, so it again moved to first for loop. So after this, all the statements are executed inside our inner for loop. Now this will execute at the last. Increment the value of I by 1. I value will become 2 now on the right hand side. So I value will become 2 on the right hand side. So 2 is less than 2, equals to 2, condition true. 2 is equals to 2, condition true. Again we will come inside. It will only, now it will again run one time. So now it will run one time. J value will become 2 now. Condition false. Again this will terminate. But after this, as of now, I value is 2. This will execute at the last. I value will become 3 now. Right? So now after I value will become 3, this condition false. So now this for loop will terminate, because if this condition is false, how this will execute, right? Because it is inside this. So once after this condition false, we will come out of our for loop and it will print hello 2 times. So is it clear to everyone how it is executing? It is called as nested for loop, because one for loop is inside another for loop.
So why do you use such for loop?
Sorry?
Do we use the system inside for loop?
We use? Can you repeat?
We are using system for loop.
Yeah.
Is there such case in practical?
Suppose if you want to, let me remove this. So there are many ways, like if I explain, suppose if you want to print this, if you want to print 4 star, if you want to, sorry, let me take some other example. Suppose I want to print the even number, but I want to print, we have already seen one example that, let me remove this. I want to check whether a number is even or odd, right? We have already seen that if suppose int number equals to 9, how I want to check? I want to check whether the number 9 is even or odd. So I will say if number, for this example we have already covered, 9 equals to equals to 0, I will say number is even, right? So this example is clear to everyone, I hope, right? Which we have already seen. But if the number is not equal to 9, I will say number is odd. Can anyone confirm whether they are able to get this example or not, which we have discussed?
Yeah.
Okay, so here I'm simply checking, sorry, it should be 2. So if the number is completely divisible by 2, it is even number. So here the number will be odd, so we will see output as odd in the output. Suppose I want to, or let me take suppose I want to okay, so that here in this case it will not be applicable. Okay, let us see some other example. If I take this example, suppose I want to print this 4 star in our output, so how we can print? Int I equals to 1, I less than equals to 4, increment the I. So here one for loop will do the work for you. So I will say star, right? And if I comment this, if I want to 4 star in our output, so if I remove, okay, let me first print, run as Java application, right? So these are called the pattern programs. So as of now I want to print in this fashion. So how we can print? If I remove ln from here, now it will not change the line, Right. Suppose so this time we got only one output, right? But if I want to print, how we want to print, let me write it here. I want to print like this. 1, 2, 3. Like this. If I want to print this Python program, one for loop will not going to do the work for us. Here we need to take the help of one more for loop. So let us see how we can do that. Here we will require another for loop, which is called as nested for loop. So what I will do, I will take one more j equals to 1, j less than equals to 4 plus plus I. And here I will simply print this.
Here it will be plus plus j or plus plus I.
Sorry, plus plus j. Okay, and now, so it should be integer. So declare this variable as integer. Now, one for loop will not going to print. So this we can print with the help of one for loop. But if you want to print in this square fashion, here the for loop will not going to do the work for us. Here if you see this. So what we can do here. Yeah, so first what I'm doing, let me write it here. As you can see, there are total how many rows are here? Row number 1, row number 2, row number 3, row number 4. Total 4 rows we are having. So I'll execute outer for loop 4 times. It will execute 4 times. So this is what I have taken. And here I need to have 4 star in every row. So this will going to print all the star. So total it will print 4 star. So if I run this program, let us see what it will print. So as of now, we will not get the output. So you can see 1, 1, then 2, then 3, and then 4. So but here we want one after the other. So what I will do, once this will execute, I will change the line. So if you write like this, this statement, it will simply change the line. So now you will see, with the help of two for loops, we are able to print this star pattern. If you try to do that with the help of one loop, it will not going to help you, right? So in that cases, you can use a nested for loop. So there are many ways we will come across in the coming videos, in the coming lectures, where we will going to use multiple, where we will going to use nested for loop. Is it clear to everyone?
Sir, by using two loops, what is the use of plus plus i then?
Yeah, I am coming to this point after this. It is basically incrementing the value of I by 1. If I say plus plus I, or here if I say I plus plus, that will not going to affect your output. I will tell you why. But here basically this is meaning that incrementing the value of I by 1. You can also write it here like this. I equals to I plus 1. So again, you will get the same output. Right? So plus plus I or I plus plus here meaning that incrementing the value of I by 1. So basically, this is called as pre-increment. Pre-increment operator plus plus I. And if I write I plus plus, it is called as post decrement. So we will see that in while loop how it will affect our output. So is it, so first tell me, whether are you able to get why we are using nested for loop?
Yes, sir.
Let me try to take one more example. Okay, I will take. I am not getting in my mind as of now. So this is one such example where we can use nested for loop.
I have a question. So plus plus I or I plus plus is same, right?
No, it is not same. But here it will not going to affect your output. I will discuss while loop now. You will going to see the effect. They both are not same. Here it will not affect the output because only one statement is there. Right? But we will see, right?
Okay.
Let me remove this. Suppose if I write int j, let me take int I equals to 1, int I equals to 1, right, and int j plus plus I, And if I print the value, right? So if I write plus plus I, it is called as 3 increment. Sorry, 3 increment operator. Meaning that if I say plus plus I, which means first increase or increment, first increase the value of I by 1 and then use it. What does this mean? If I try to execute this program, here if I say value of j equals to plus j. So basically this is a string and this is a variable. This is our variable j. So I need to separate them using concatenation operator. So this is not the addition operator here. It is basically concatenate, which means merge the string and the variable value. So what does this mean? If I run this program, first I equals to 1 will be created in your output. So I equals to 1, okay, so I equals to 1 will be created. I equals to 1 is created, you can see on the right hand side. So if you see this statement plus plus I, it is saying it is a pre-increment operator if you put plus plus before, right? And I am saying, and it will say that first increase the value of I by 1. So what is the value of I? After this, value of I will become 2, and now that 2 will be assigned to this variable j. So this is how it will work here. So if I run this, so now after value of I will be incremented by 1, it will become 2, and 2 will be assigned to variable j. So this is the reason we are seeing value of j in our output as 2, right? But if I write instead of this one, if I say one more here, int k equals to, you can say I plus plus. So here I am giving plus plus at the end. So it is called as post increment operator, which means it will, let me put some space, it will tell first you can use the value, use the value of I and later increment the value. So how this will work, let me run it. So let us also print the value of k. So if I print value of k, so if I put k here, value of k, so let us see how both these will work. If I run it again, so see it clearly, I am debugging the program. What are the difference between this one and this one? So again, let me explain. So now here it is a plus plus I, which means first of all, whatever be the value of I, on the right hand side you can see I equals to 1, first this will increment and then this value will be assigned to the variable j, right? So if I run it, it will be it, this plus plus I will going to give, make the value of I equals to 2, and this value 2 will be assigned to j, as this is a pre-increment operator. So now you can see value of I will increment by 2 and that value is assigned to j, right? But here if you see this, it is a post increment operator, which means plus plus is put at the end, right? So as of now you can see value of I is equals to 2. Or let me take one more thing, instead of taking I again, let us make value of I equals to 1, right? I am just making the value of I equals to 1 again, so it will not create the confusion. So now, so this three statement we have already seen. Now j value is 2, right? J value is 2, and I am making the value of I equals to 1 again. So focus on the value of I equals to 1, right? So but here it will not going to make 2 first. What it will do, it is saying first you can use the value of I, which means what is the value of I? Value of I equals to 1, and this 1 will be assigned to the variable k. So this 1 will be assigned to the variable k, and once this assigning operation is done, later you can increment the value. So this is what I have written, later increment the value. So first 1 will be given to k, variable k. So it should be 1. So you can see value of k will become 1. And after that, this plus plus operator has increased the value of i by 2. So again, I value has become 2. So this is our post increment operator. And after that, you can see again, it will print value of j and k as k will be 1, because first 1 will be assigned to the variable k, and after that I value has increased. So is it clear to everyone? What is the difference?
Yeah, I have a question regarding the logical end and or bitwise end. So can you please let us know that
we will see those operators in our coming videos, right?
Okay.
No, not worry.
Yeah, okay, that's fine.
So first tell me whether this is clear to everyone.
Sir, can you explain again?
Okay. So what we have to do, let me try it here. Let me, if I write int I equals to 1, right? If I say int I equals to 1, and if I say integer j equals to plus plus I. So this is a pre-increment operator. So how this will work? And if I print the value of j, so this will print the value. So first I equals to 1 will be created. So I equals to 1 will be created in the memory area, right? So this line is done. And once it will come to this line, as it is a plus plus I, which means first it will increment the value of I. So let us increment the value of I. It will become 2, right? So value of I is incremented by 1. And now this value 2 will be given to the to this variable. So this j will have 2, and it will print 2 in the output. So this is what our pre-increment operator says. And there is one more. If I take int I equals to 1, int j equals to I plus plus. So this is post-increment operator. And here if I say system.out.println j, right? So if I do this, how it will work? As it is a I plus plus, not plus plus I. So first of all, I value equals to 1 will be created. So this is I. I equals to 1 will be created, right? Now after that, I'm saying I plus plus, which means whatever the value of I you are getting from the first line, you can first use that value. So what will happen? Whatever the value of I, which is 1. So first 1 will be given to variable j. So variable j will have. So variable j will be created having the value as 1. Because we have given the value of I to j. Value of I is 1. And once you have given the value, perform this part. So which means increment the value of I. So now this will become 2. So now this way you are getting 1 and I equals to 2. So this is the difference. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is basically.
Sir, can you repeat right hand side again?
Yeah. So what I am saying, let me. So first I equals to 1 will be created. I equals to 1 is created in our memory area. This is the value we have created. This first line is done. Now int j equals to I plus plus. As plus plus is at the end after variable. So first this part will be executed, first part. What is the value of I? Value of I is 1. So that 1 will be given to this one. 1 will be given to j. So j value will become 1. J value will become 1. And after that, as after assigning operation is done, plus plus will be performed after this, right? So after this, you can say it will become 2. So because the value of I will change, right? So j value part is done. Assignment operation is done. But after all this, plus plus will perform. So I value will become 2. So this is how it will work.
Got it.
Okay. So here if you see, if I write for loop, in the for loop, we are not getting any data. We are not getting incorrect result. Whatever the result we are using, if you see, int I equals to 1 I less than 2 plus plus I. So here if you see this plus plus I, it is only a single statement. What this plus plus I will do? Here we are combining the two operation. Earlier what we are doing? Here I am using I plus plus or plus plus I with one more variable on the left hand side. But here there is no such variable. So anyways, once the value of I will increment, it will be assigned to I. So that is the reason whatever the I plus plus or plus plus I am using, here it will not going to make any change in the for loop. Right? So if I write hello, so if I write plus plus I, the result will be same. If I use I plus plus, then also result will be same because there is no other statement. It is a single statement after semicolon. So here there is no not much change. But if I use while loop, right? So this is it has printed hello 2 times, right? So let us try to see how this what is the syntax of while loop will look like. So first is this one. So let me write while. So let me take one variable int I equals to 1. While I is less than equals to 5, I is less than equals to 5. In the inside of this one, I will print hello. And I will print after that I will increment the value of I. So if you look the for loop, it is almost derived from the for loop only. If you see I equals to 1, I less than equals to 5, plus plus I, right? If I print hello, and if I say after printing hello, if I write what I have to write, I have to write nothing. So if you see this, compare this with for loop. First I equals to one. First, after that condition checking here, right? So once the condition will be checked, we will go inside. Here as well, we will go inside, right? It will print hello. So again, it will print hello 1 time, and at the end, plus plus I will be done. Here at the end as well, plus plus I will be done, right? So it is almost similar if you can see here, right? So what is the syntax? This is the syntax on the left hand side. We can use this while loop. So if I run it here, it will give us the same output. Let us check. So first let me take variable. It will run only 1 time. This will run only 1 time. Right? And I will say while I is less than equals to 4, system.out.println, I will say hello. And after that, so make sure you are putting one condition. If we do not put inner condition, what will happen? I am not putting any inner condition, so this will run infinite time. You can see it is not stopping because I value is always 1. So condition, it will run infinite time. So you can flip this, break, terminate, it will terminate. So let me put one condition so that it can stop plus plus I. And if I run it, if I run this, debug this, so now I equals to 1 is 1 is less than equals to 4, 1 is less than 4, condition true. We will go inside, it will print hello, and I value will become 2. You can see on the right hand side, I value will become 2 after I click this. I value become 2. So 2 is less than 4, condition true, again hello will be printed. Now I value will become 3. So is 3 less than 4, condition true, again inside we will go, hello will be printed. Now I value will become 4. So if you see, 4 is not less than 4, but 4 is equals to 4. 4 is equals to 4, condition true, we will go inside, hello will be printed. And after that, I value will become 5. So is 5 is less than 4? 5 is not less than equals to 4, condition false. So we will simply come out of our while loop. So this is how it will work. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Suppose if I use I plus plus or plus plus I here, now you will see the difference here. So how it will work? If I write plus plus I, okay, I should have written not here. Sorry, not yet. Right here. So this view I think already seen. By okay, I think I have confused myself. We have already seen, right, this one plus plus I, because here there is only simple statement, so it is not going to affect us at all. Okay, I should have written like this, I plus plus less than 4, right? So let us see what it will print first. So we have to increment the value of I anyways inside. So let us see how it is working. Again, now there are two statements. Okay, so let us see if I say plus plus I, if I say plus plus I, will it make a difference? So you can see some difference is coming if I changing it. So when I plus plus less than 4, when I plus plus less than 4, it is printing hello 2 times. So why it is printing 2 times, let me explain here only. So if I, let me take to check it here. So here, so our program is I equals to 1 while I plus less than 4 hello and then plus plus I. Inside that we are printing hello system dot out dot println hello, and then I will say plus plus I, right? So it is printing hello 2 times as our Eclipse editor is displaying 2 times. So what will happen? I plus plus. Okay. So now I equals to 1. First of all, this first line will be executed. This line executed. Now if you see this I plus plus less than 4, this is a post increment operator. So what does this mean? First you can use the value of I. What use the value of I means, you can use one value and compare it with 4. So is 1 is less than 4 condition true? So we will go inside. So once this comparison part is done, later we will increment the value of I. So first we will come inside. And now this I value will become 2, right? Because it is post increment. So it will print hello. So hello will be printed, right? And now plus plus I, because it is only single statement, we will not going to see any difference. Now increment the value of I by 1. So now plus plus I will again make the value of I to 3. So this will become 3, right? After that, again, we will, after execution of this, we will again come here. Now if you see this I plus plus less than 4, right? Now I value is 3, it is a post increment. So again we need to first compare value of I which we are already having with 4. So 3 is less than 4, condition true, and we will go inside. And later the value of I will be incremented by 1 due to post increment. So now this will become 4, right? It will print hello, it will print hello 2 times as we have seen in the Eclipse editor. Now this will again make the value of I by 1. So it will become 5, right? And now once this condition will be checked, I plus plus less than 4. If you see, this condition will become false because value phi is 5 we are having and it is less than 4. So this condition will become false and we will simply come out of our loop. So this is how this is working. Are you able to get that? How this is work in this case? Okay, I hope it is clear to everyone. So let us see, if I say plus plus I, how this will work. In the plus plus I, we were seeing only one hello in our output. So in case of plus plus I, if I write, plus I, right? Now here if I say plus plus I here, you will see output as only one hello. So why it is printing only one time hello? Only one hello is printed. So if you see, first i equals to 1 will be in our output, right? I equals to 1. Now plus plus I, this is the condition. So it is a pre-increment operator, which means first increment the value of I, then do the comparison part. So first increment the value of I, which is 2. Now this value will become 2 and it is 2 is less than 4, condition true. We will go inside, right? So hello will be printed one time. Now after that, plus plus I will be encountered again and this will make the value of I equals to 3. So I value has become 3 now. Now after that, this condition will again be checked. So plus plus I less than 4, right? So now I value is 3. So it is a pre-increment, which means first increment the value of I, then compare. So I value will become 4. So now this whole statement has given us the value 4. Is 4 is less than 4? Condition false. So if the condition is false, we will simply come out of our while loop. So in this case, that's the reason it is only printing hello one time. So this is how pre-increment and the post-increment operators will affect in case of while loop. Is it clear to everyone? If you write I plus
yes,
plus,
yes.
If you write like this single time, not with any other operator, or you can say not with any other variable, then it will not going to affect. Otherwise it will make the changes accordingly, which we have seen, right? Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
So we will see the do while loop in the next class, and I will also share the recording. This time you will not miss the recording. Okay, so that's all for today. So thank you everyone for attending. I will share the recording as soon as possible.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
For every keyword that the integer float having a default value 0, but what is the default value or default character for keyword character?
Can you write your question? I am not clear with your question. Write that. So guys, anyone who wants to leave, they can leave. Rest can stay if they have any. Please write your question in the chat box.
Yes.